another series on Easter Sunday, so we will finish the One Another series today. Will you agree with me that the problem with loving people is because they often act like people? They'll take the last duchy in the Timmies right before you, and it's the last day that they bake duchies. They'll stop where you have to turn in to talk to their friends, and you're in such a hurry to get home to go make dinner. They'll break your heart. They'll break their promises. Sometimes it's just so difficult to love people, because they just act like people. Word has something to say about that. 1 John chapter 4, verse 10 and 11 says, and I'm reading from the New Century Version, this is what real love is. It's not our love for God, it's God's love for us. He sent his son to die in our place and to take away our sins. My dear friends, if God loved us that much, we also should love each other or one another. So if I read John right, it seems to me he says this: if I want to learn how to love others, I first have to understand God's love for me. Does that make sense? Because here's the thing. I think the whole Bible can be reduced to this one line: God loves you, so let him. He doesn't love you because you're so lovable. You're right, Bonnie. Because often we're not. More than once, we're not that lovable. He loves us because God chooses to love us. Passionately, personally, intimately, eternally wants to love us. And that's the message of Easter. All of our doubts about God's love for me just disappear in the presence of the risen Christ. So hold that. That's going to be the foundation on which we're going to build the rest of the story. So I'm going to read with you the story of the resurrection. And I always say the two most difficult times of the year for me to preach is Christmas and Easter, because it's the same story. How do you say something new? Let's try. We're going to read the one from John, in John chapter 20, and we're going to break it down in little pieces. Verse 1 says, early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So right here at the beginning, it's dark, and in the dark, we meet this woman called Mary Magdalene. Actually means Mary from a place called Magdala. This Mary, we don't know much about her. Luke tells us in Luke chapter 8, reminds us that she was filled with seven demons. What that means within the biblical context, what that meant in those days, we don't know. We just know it's something that affected her life, not for the good. But then something happened in her life. Actually, someone happened in her life. Jesus walked into her life, removed these demons from her life. And for the first time, Mary could smile. Mary could look in that mirror and have peace with her own life. Mary became one of Jesus' most faithful followers. John 19 tells us that Mary was there on that day when they crucified Jesus. She stood at that cross. She saw the agony. She heard the cries. She saw him die. She saw them take him away and put him in a grave. And then came the Sabbath Sunday. Must have been the longest Saturday in her whole life, because on a Sabbath you can't do anything. And maybe that's why so early that Sunday morning Mary was out there. It was still dark, but Mary was on her way to the tomb. And things quickly went from bad to worse. Because when she got there, the stone was rolled away. And for her first thought in her mind was, they took him away. That's what the religious leaders would have done. They took the body and they buried it where we couldn't see it, where we couldn't come and take care of him, where we couldn't come and have a place where we could mourn. He's gone. He's done. Worst case scenario has happened. And so we read. Verse 2. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one that Jesus loved. That's John. And she said, they've taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they've put him. So Peter and the other disciples started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. And then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple who had reached the tomb first also went inside. He saw and believed. But they still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to where they were staying. Now we'd expect the camera to follow Peter and John to where the other disciples was and hear what they were going to say to the disciples. Doesn't. Camera pans right back to Mary. Now Mary stood outside the tomb crying. And as she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white. Luke calls them two men because that's how angels look, like people. She saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head, the other at the foot. And they asked her, woman, why are you crying? They've taken my Lord away, she said, and I don't know where they've put him. Can we just stop there for a second? In this moment, Mary hits rock bottom. Her life is dark. Her life is empty. Her life is taken away. Maybe you can relate. Maybe you've also experienced those moments where things went from bad to worse before they got better. Maybe you too have walked under that cloud of doubt and struggle and pain, seeking the face of Jesus. Just not finding, hitting rock bottom. If that's true for you, I can't wait to share the rest of this story with you that's coming. So look what happens. The sun, and spell sun, S-O-N, the sun comes up for Mary. At this, she turned around and she saw Jesus standing there, but, and there's your biblical but she did not realize that it was Jesus. And he asked her, woman, why are you crying? Who is it you're looking for? Thinking he was the gardener, she said, sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you've put him and I will get him. Jesus said to her, Mary? She turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, Rabuni, which means teacher. And Jesus says, do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. In her darkness, in this moment of being overwhelmed, Mary does not recognize Jesus. And again, I ask myself the question, can you relate, Aubrey? How often when we're in that dark and in that difficulty, Jesus might be there, but I just don't see him. So what does Jesus do? The most gentle, kind thing. He just says, Mary. Remember I preached a sermon for you on that 2 years ago? He said it in Aramaic, actually. I don't know why we put Mary in there. Actually, the Greek word there that they use from the Aramaic is Miriam. All he said was, Miriam? Maybe it was the way in which he said that name. Maybe it was the intonation in his voice. Maybe it was just the kindness that came with that. Because just that one word, and Mary knew. Rabuni, my teacher, she cried. And in that moment, Mary's life changes from this dark, lost moment to this bright, light, alive in Christ moment. From being crushed to being overwhelmed by joy. And she does this amazing thing. She just throws her arms around Jesus. And I'll preach you a sermon on that one day, just on the holding. Because it sounds like he's saying, leave me alone. No, 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 it's not what he's saying. In that moment, he's not too holy to allow Mary just to put her arms around him and just share that love of a child that is seeking. See, here's the thing. I think Easter has this sacred meaning in our lives. Two things. It doesn't just speak of Christ's power over death, but it speaks of this amazing love of God. The power that says, death, you're done, you're taken care of, but maybe even more beautiful than that. That unfathomable, sometimes inexplicable love that God has for Miriam, people like us. You see, that's so Jesus. Verse 18. Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news. I've seen the Lord. And she told them that he had said all these things to her. Why Mary? We don't read about her again, ever. She's just gone after this. I think there's only one reason. Because that's what love does. Love shows up in those sad moments. Love shows up when times are hard. Love shows up when I'm going through those deep, dark valleys. Love shows up. Will you hear that? Jesus loved Mary, but Jesus loves you. Boundless love. He loves you so much that he knows your name. He looks at you, Scotty, and he says, that's my Scotty, who stands up there and leads us in worship. He looks at Alexander and he says, that's my Alexander, who makes sure that all the stuff is there and all the banners are up and all the things are taken care of. We don't even know about that. He knows you. You know what he says? Write this down, Isaiah 49, verse 2. I have written your name in the palm of my hands, and I will never forget you. God doesn't need a name tag to be reminded who you are. You are always on God's mind. He is fond of you. And you're thinking, really? You must be talking about someone else. Someone wiser, someone holier, someone better than me. Someone who is not addicted to porn or pills or possessions or popularity. Here's the thing, not talking about someone else, talking about you. He knows your name and he loves you. He loved you even before you knew him. He loves you even when you forget about him. That's just Jesus. Why? I'll tell you why. Because there's a little bit of God in each one of us. He breathed his own breath, his life, into us. And he made us his children. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. Can you remember what it says? You are God's. Poema, Greek word, God's masterpieces. You're not just a teenager, a boy, a girl, a man, a woman. You're God's child that is loved by God. You're God's idea. Can I tell you something? God doesn't have bad ideas. Belong to him, and he loves you, and Easter tells you that. So here's your Easter assignment. Allow God to love you. And then what happens is going to take you right back to where I started, because we're talking also about one another. When I start understanding this love of God that is overwhelming in our lives, that does not depend on me, because God's love does not depend on me. It depends on God. When this love starts coming into my life and touches my life and my heart changes and it becomes gentle and soft and kind. And then I look at people, and even when they're just doing people things, I learn how to love like God. So go live. And in those moments when it feels like it's dark and it's hard, just listen. Just listen. And you'll hear. I love you. And let him. Amen. Take a few moments of silent prayer. Thank you for your amazing love, Father God. Seeing us walk in darkness and lost, and then sending the light of the world into this world. And despite, Lord, of the messes in our lives, things that we don't do, things that we should do, you love. You love with passion. You love intimately, and your love just never ends. We don't always understand that, but help us to live that. As day by day we walk in your love and grow more and more in our faith in you. Thank you for the open tomb and for the life you give. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to take a moment to give of our gifts to the Lord, and while we do